Hi, my name is Sam Sieber, and I'm a biologist who's been working with alkaline hydrolysis or aquamation for over 15 years. Today, a question from a glass artist came across my desk, and regarding the use of aquamation ashes and making some memorial products, like is often done with flame cremation ashes, and they do behave differently. And the questions were really good, so I wanted to address those and maybe share this conversation with the glass artist community, because ultimately I think these memorial products are amazing for families, and I want them to be accessible to the growing number of people who are choosing aquamation for their pets and human loved ones. So it can be done every bit as safely as working with flame cremation ashes. For those who do that, you still have to take the same precautions that you have to take in your line of work, obviously, as far as occupational health and safety goes. But I'll tell you what's different and why it's that way. And then hopefully by having this discussion, we can be sure that people have this option available. So the reason that this question came into me today is because a glass artist who has worked with aquamation ashes and flame cremation ashes made a post in a community forum for other glass artists. And the post basically, I'm going to kind of read this. It basically explained the aquamation process, which I'm going to pause and explain that to you real quick. So this is an alternative to flame cremation and burial. It's just another option that families have for human and pets. The process uses a solution of 95% water and 5% alkali. So the alkali is a chemical. It's either potassium hydroxide or a combination of potassium hydroxide and sodium hydroxide. And these are chemicals that are used in a lot of different industries. They're available everywhere because they're used in so many industries. Food industries for fruit peeling, also soap making industries, anybody that's selling that artisan bar soap that's awesome at the farmer's market is using sodium hydroxide. If they're selling liquid soap, they're using potassium hydroxide. So these are very caustic chemicals that have a high pH. Alkaline hydrolysis uses it in a solution of 95% water and 5% of the potassium and sodium hydroxide. So the way that the process works to accomplish the end product, which are ashes, is this solution is circulated for a period of time, and water molecules, which are amazing decomposers, water is a great decomposer anywhere in nature, as the people that live on the coast, you know, they're always fighting it. It's a decomposer for organic matter, and it's a decomposer for our bodies. And so in this system, we put it in the ideal situation. So it accomplishes what would take years for a body buried in the soil. This accomplishes in a small period of time. The one way it does, one of many ways it does that is with the chemical that's added, because it raises the pH really high. And in that environment, a water molecule dissociates into hydrogen and hydroxide ions and breaks bonds. It's a major bond breaker. We add heat, which speeds up reactions. That's just a basic chemistry principle. And we add water circulation, which speeds up the rate of reaction as well. That's called collision theory in chemistry. So we just get the ideal situation. It does it in a very controlled environment. It produces, it basically reduces the body down to its most basic building blocks. So the solution is amino acids. There's no protein, there's no DNA, there's no RNA. Everything's broken down as small as it can be. So fats are broken down into soaps, and the body, you know, proteins are broken down into amino acids. And so that's what the solution is. And then you have the inorganic bone remains, which look just like the full skeletal remains. So these bone remains are fully rinsed. It goes through a series of rinse cycle. They're dried. They are sterile. So this is validated. They're pathogen free. No fungi, bacteria, viruses, they are completely sterile. So they're safe to handle. There's no chemical residue. So the alkali, which has a pH of 14 at the beginning of the process, by the end of the process, that's all gone. There is no chemical left in the final ash remains. The pH is down to, you know, it depends on the municipality, but 10 before water at pH of 7 comes in and performs full rinses. So there is no chemical residue at all on these remains. I think that's an important point to make. You're not burning this chemical. So those are dried, they're processed into a powder. The ashes, same processors used for flame cremation as it is for alkaline hydrolysis, same processor. It's just that there's more ashes from aquamation because we're operating at 200 or 300 degrees instead of 1600 or 1800 degrees. So we don't lose any of that calcium phosphate up the stack. We're not that hot. It's the process is very gentle to the mineral remains that are left, AKA the ashes. And so you get more of it. And then it breaks down into more of a powder because just the way that the process, you know, it gets inside the bone and breaks down that network. And so you get more of a powder versus cremation ashes, which vary, but sometimes they're a little bit larger particle size and more chippy. The bone is a little bit, has a little bit more strength left after the flame cremation process, but it's all calcium phosphate. So here's the differences. So the ash from aquamation is a powder. Whether that makes them harder to work with or not for a glass artist, I don't know. Whether it makes them a little dusty to work with, I don't know. You don't ever want to breathe in any kind of dust, whether it's dust out at a baseball diamond or dust from a process. It doesn't matter. Construction dust, no dust is good for your lungs. So if whatever you guys do with the ashes, I'll have to learn about that. If it's a process that generates dust, you want to wear a dust protection. So I don't know if that would be a respirator or a dust mask, but you want to protect yourself from breathing in any kind of dust. There's nothing especially hazardous about the dust from this process, but it's a protection that you want to take. The person on the forum in their post, they talked about the SDS sheet for potassium hydroxide. I've already addressed that. That's not in the remains. It's just not. That would be like looking up the SDS sheet for natural gas and propane, which are very scary if you look at them, but they're not in the final cremation remains. The alkali that's used in the process isn't in the final alkaline hydrolysis remains. It's just not there. So that's a non-issue. You're not working with the chemical. That's not what this is. Now, when you touch the glass at these extreme temperatures to the powder from aquamation ashes, it poofs a little flame and releases a little smoke. And that is a fast reaction. So first of all, there's two things contributing to that. One is the fact that it's a powder, more of a powder, and then regular flame cremation ashes. And the second is that there's more organic matter that can burn, more carbon. So I'll address those separately. Powders burn more, so they're more flammable. So flour that you keep in your kitchen is very flammable. Spices in your herb cabinet are very flammable versus the more whole version because there's more surface area that has immediate contact with the heat all at once. And so that's just a chemistry principle with combustion. So it's more of a powder, so you're gonna get a little bit more of a fast instant reaction from it with the organic matter that's contained in it. So the organic matter is gonna be carbon-based things. What is in ashes that's carbon-based? Well, life is carbon-based, but there's not that much in flame cremation ashes because they are burned at 1600 to 1800 degrees in their process. So most of the carbon is burnt, okay? There is some carbon left, and I'll address the scientific evidence for that. With aquamation, this process is running at 200 to 300 degrees. So there's no burning off of carbon. Carbon's broken down and most of it's gone, but even the rinse processes that we do, there are some trace amounts of carbon that are left on the remains. And that would be just some trace amounts of amino acids, and some, which is as small as you can go, you know, and trace amounts of some soap residue. So, you know, these remains dry fine, they process fine. You can do anything with them that you can do with flame cremation ashes, but there's a little bit more carbon in them. So, let's see. I think more on the carbon topic is that anything with carbon is going to react with the temperatures that you're working with your glass work. So that would be wood, hair, plastics, furniture, clothing. These are all carbon containing things. There's not a lot, there's hair is about a third carbon. And so that's going to be a bigger reaction than anything that you have with ashes. Ashes have a lot of that carbon reduced, including aquamation ashes. So hair is dead, but it is carbon-based. It's about a third carbon. Aquamation ashes have about half as much carbon as hair. And cremation ashes, because they've been burnt all the goodness, have about a fifth the carbon content than aquamation ashes. So there's just more carbon to react to the extreme heat. And these ashes have never been exposed to that kind of extreme heat. So there is a flash reaction. What that means for a glass artist is, I think the steps to take here are, one, to be knowledgeable about the difference. Expect that they're going to react differently. Maybe some people can post some videos, or you can talk to some people, or just take some extra precautions that it's gonna produce a little poof of a flame. When you press the glass, you know, into the ashes, it's gonna react with the organic carbon. And so being aware of that is step one. And making sure, I think step two is making sure your space, including ventilation, is proper for handling that. So you should have ventilation in your space. And I know everybody's facility and workspace is different, but you need to have something to pull anything away from your, you know, away from your face, or you need to wear a respirator. So I'm going to let you guys who are an expert with working with, you know, your art form handle that, but you might need to consider ventilation. You're going to need adequate ventilation. And, you know, that's a function of, it's different. As an example, we do here at BioResponse, our welders, we have multiple welders out here, and the ventilation precautions that we take at every separate station are a little bit different depending on room size, gases worked with, and a lot of different things. But we provide adequate ventilation, which varies space to space. We provide adequate ventilation for our welders. You're just gonna have to make sure you have that. Let's see. I think I covered that, that the most of the carbon, that the organic matter that's on the remains is just soap residue. So it's biodegradable. It's not toxic. You're not breathing a toxic fume from the chemical or anything like that. There's no funky gases. It does have a smell. And I think that's what scares people if they don't know what it is. So I want to tell you what it is. The smell is ammonia. And it's a constituent of the soap, and it's a constituent of amino acids. When proteins are broken down, it liberates ammonia. So some of the residue that would be present is ammonia. And ammonia has a tinge. So if you walk into a horse barn after a horse has just peed, I mean, it burns. And so this is a small amount. If you have good ventilation, you shouldn't smell it. But this particular artist said that it left a smell and kind of a taste to the tongue. You gotta wear a respirator or whatever you can safely do while you're working with this. I don't know if that inhibits your, you know, if that is okay to wear while you're working with us, or if that's very difficult. But this is the discussion I want to have with you. It's just ammonia though. And so, and it's not an amount that would be harmful, but it's also just like any kind of dust. You just don't want to breathe any kind of fume. It's not that it's acutely toxic. It's just, if you're going to be working with this stuff, just put in the, take the precautions to not breathe it in. I think that covered all the points. So my email is sam@bioresponsesolutions.com. I'm interested in continuing this conversation because I'm really passionate about families having access to these types of memorial products. And there's not a scientific basis for them not being able, for, you know, artists to not work with it and for people to not have this available. And I'm afraid that families are gonna start to get turned away for this type of memorial product because artists don't have the information they need to assess whether they can work safely with it. So that's why I'm here. How can we work together? I can be reached by phone 317-386-3500. I want these products to be available for families. I want artists to feel comfortable and safe. I want precautions to be taken properly. And how do we do this? Hey, I'm back. I forgot something. Two points that I briefly mentioned that I wanted to talk about, give you some resources. One is when I talk about the carbon content of flame cremation ashes and aquamation ashes, to give you a resource that you can find right now to kind of peek into that if you're curious what the carbon content, organic content is in each of these substances. You can actually Google Eterniva, Aquamation, and carbon, because a lot of the research on what's actually in these ashes at such a small scale has come from another art form, which is using carbon from ashes or from hair to create to grow a man-made memorial diamond. And so there really hasn't been such a need for such meticulous analysis until that technology came along and people, they did a lot of testing for transparency to consumers so that consumers could understand that, you know, what's actually being used to make the diamond. So if you Google that, that'll show you some of the carbon. Now, as for when I talk to you about what's present in the liquid residue that's on the aquamation ashes that produces the odor, I said that that's ammonia. That is based on laboratory analysis. So there's 25 years of analysis of the liquid from the alkaline hydrolysis process. And I thought you might want a little bit more specific info there. There's ammonia can be pungent to your nose because it's because of the small particles and the extreme temperature, and that reaction is happening in a flash as soon as your hot glass touches that powder. It's happening so fast, so it's releasing it all at once. It could be a pungent smell to your nose. You do want to, like I said, have adequate ventilation or wear respiratory protection, but it's just ammonia. There's not a funky gas. It's not a chemical being burned. And the residue, the liquid residue that could be present on the surface of this material, it's been analyzed. There's no VOCs, which are volatile organic compounds. There's no PCBs. There's no furans. There's no dioxins. These are things that authorities have looked at for many years. And so I'm not just pulling this out of my, you know, out of my ear that it's just ammonia, but it's just ammonia. And dog food is something that has an ammonia smell. Like I mentioned, different types of urine. If you're in my barn, bat urine has a pungent ammonia smell. So it's not the most pleasant thing, but it's also not the worst thing either. So, okay, I think that covers it. Thanks all.